And one of the best, which I did not see coming, because I started watching this game, J.A., probably early third quarter. Or no, yeah, it was early third quarter. It was just after halftime. And I looked at the Dallas-Phoenix score, and I said, okay, just in case people thought Game 7 last year was a fluke, Dallas is letting you further know that they know what it takes to knock the Phoenix Suns around. And I thought, oh, wow, Phoenix, after all that talk about the offseason, they're just doing the same thing they did in Game 7. And it was an amazing comeback for the Suns. And one thing stands out, well, a couple of things stand out to me, but I think the Suns, they got a little more grit and a little more toughness than we talked about in the offseason. And two, I still can't put Luka in my top five playing defense like that. I can't do it. He's an amazing, sublime offensive talent. J.A., I cannot call you a top five player if you don't even give me some courtesy defense. You don't give me some shadow defense, I can't go there. What do you think?
I don't think this was a referendum on Luka last night. To me, this was more about the Suns, and it depends on which way you view the glass,
so
or
kind,
as
Dave.
I put, do you
Professor
see them
Adande.
Rising
Professor
or
standing? Professor Adande, you're so kind today.
You can give him credit, because it like I don't get my final grade in the first week of class, Michael. That's how it goes. You know, you have to wait for the course to play
out.
Then
you
I do
made,
my final
you make
evaluation.
You made up your mind, though. You made up your mind, though.
They give him a full choice. I haven't made up my I'm leaning some ways. And to me, I'm more disturbed by the fact you can look at the way that the Suns came back and won that game. But what were they doing down in the first place, especially when this was your revenge game? The NBA did them a solid and let them open at home against the team that put them out of the playoffs last year. So this is a favor to you. You get to get your revenge. You get to pinpoint this game from the moment the schedule comes out and say, oh, we didn't like the way we went out last year. They're coming back into our building? No, we taking them. And what happens? You get down by 22? How does that happen? So I'm concerned about that.
Yeah.
That's a red alarm right there. The other concerning thing about this game, you can say it's a good thing because it shows the depth of this team, but I'm concerned they won this game with Chris Paul sitting the final few minutes on the bench. And he had a little pad on his right leg as well. I don't know if it was ice or heat or what was going on there, or if that was the reason it was sitting out or what. None of it looked good. And it felt like the beginning of the end of CP3 as we've known it.
Hold on.
That's one of the themes here, Michael, is that this is, you know, the Redeem Team era. They've got the new documentary out. They've also got the podcast Jeff McCallum and I did. You can listen to that one too. They had a nice 20-year run. You look at the guys on that team. Kobe won a championship in 2000, right up through LeBron in 2020, and a lot of other ways they made that imprint on the league over the years, the last two decades. But I don't think Chris Paul is going to be there at the end this year. I don't think LeBron's going to be there at the end of this year. And they're the last two representatives standing. Maybe you can say Jason Kidd might coach the Mavericks there as a member of that team in 2008. But it's every era has to come to a conclusion. Hey, it happened for the Dream Team era. Once David Robinson won his last championship in 2003, it's the end of the Redeem Team era.
Okay. Let me just get this straight. I just want to make sure I heard you right, Professor. Great job, J.A. Adande, professor out at Northwestern University. One of the great schools in the Big Ten, if you want to go to school.
If you want a campus that's next to a lake. We got a lake. We got a lake. We're on the shores of Lake Michigan. If that matters to you.
If you want to go to class, okay, that is the best school in the Big Ten. I'm going to go Northwestern. If I go academics in the Big Ten, I got Northwestern 1. Michigan's got to be up there, right? Michigan's got to be in the top
Michigan's
5 of the Big Ten. We're going to put Purdue in there.
Awesome's pretty good. Purdue Engineering. Ooh. Purdue Engineering. Okay. Actually, Illinois Engineering is pretty good, too.
Yeah. Penn State's tough to get into, right? No, he's like, I'm talking about Northwestern. I'm not hyping up anybody.
I'm also thinking like, but, I'm still a Big Ten traditionalist guy when it was 10.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You don't want to, you can't put USC and UCLA in the Big Ten. That's going to blow my mind when that happens. But I'm saying, but I'm going to get back to this, Professor. What I've heard from you as I take notes in your class, on one hand, you say it's too early. It's not even Halloween. Whether you get the good treats or not, it's not Halloween. So we cannot write the book or even a paragraph on the Brooklyn Nets. So you're going to give them a pass. But then a team that won 64 games last year, a team that went to the NBA Finals and lost in six games a year before, great player in Chris Paul, MVP candidate, you say, ooh, I don't like, and this one game, and they won. And they won their game coming back from 22.
That doesn't disturb you. Pass,
and the team you gave a pass to looked like it wanted to be anywhere but in a basketball arena last night. Just totally clueless and just out of it. So does it concern me? No, not really. You know why? You know why it doesn't concern me? I think Chris Paul, at this stage of his career, they should, he and Monty should sit down and say, look, we're going to put you on a Kawhi Toronto Raptors schedule. That one and done in Toronto. You're going to play 60 games this year. Whether you're healthy or not, you're playing 60 games. And let's map out which 60 games you want to play. Yeah, you know, you want to play back in North Carolina in front of the home folks? The folks
at Wake Forest. Are we counting last night as one of the 60?
Yeah, that's right.
One of the 60. You didn't finish it.
I know, but I think Chris Paul, we know he's got a healthy Chris Paul. Chris Paul 10 years ago is going to get banged up. That's just what he does. But at this stage, in his late 30s, just preserve him. He's a load management player at this stage of his career. And if you can do that, he'll be fine for the postseason, theoretically. But they won.
Then can you ask him to turn it on and get you all the way through the 16 games that you need to win in the postseason? Last year, we saw him break it down at the end. He had COVID the year they went to the finals, missed a couple games. That might have actually benefited him because he had a little time off in the middle of the playoffs. But can you count on him to be all the way there through 16 games, even if you load manage him through the regular season?
Hey, thanks for watching Brother from Another on YouTube. Make sure you hit subscribe before you leave and be sure to watch us 3 to 5 p.m. Eastern Time on Peacock. Appreciate you.